What's up, guys? This is Manoj Uptani. I welcome you all on behalf of the ADPDA world. This is going to be the last chapter which is remaining and pending from our side, which is none other than mergers and acquisitions. We've already covered the entire syllabus. This was the only topic which was left. And so, as I always say, I would surely not want any of my topic to be like remaining at our end. So we have incorporated three different video presentations in which, for the first one, I'm going to discuss about the topics which you need to have the conceptual clarity, which is very much important for you to understand about mergers and acquisitions. I will be dedicating my first presentation only towards the concepts, the theory part. Post this particular presentation, the next two presentations which are going to come up, those will be about the kind of questions which have already been asked in CE final examinations, because without them, my presentations are just not complete. Thing which I started right now in the beginning phase as well, which I maintain all throughout my different chapters, that will be like continuing for the last chapter as well. So are we guys all set? Are we guys excited to hear about and understand something related to mergers and acquisitions? So what do I mean by mergers and acquisitions? Guys, always and always remember one thing. The basic layman, if you ask about someone, what do you understand by the term merger? They'll say that the two companies are basically merging. Okay, whenever it happens that a company is being absorbed by another company, in that sense that all its assets as well as liabilities, both of them are being absorbed. That is a situation where merger actually happens. The acquiring firm, the one which is going to be like acquiring the other company, they are the ones who are going to retain its name and its identity. Okay, so after a merger, the acquired firm basically, it just disappears. Okay, it ceases to exist as a separate business entity, and they basically merge in one another. That's how it's being done. But if in case I compare the merger with acquisition part, what happens in acquisition is basically it is a purchase of another business altogether. In acquisition, what happens is a particular sale contract is executed completely, under which the buyer assumes all or maybe some of the seller's assets and assumes maybe some of the or completely its liabilities. And that's how it's being done. Merger is something wherein two people merge together with one particular thing. Let's say A company merged with B company, okay, and they formed AB company. That will be an example of merger. But if I'll talk about acquisition, what happens in acquisition is A company acquired B company. So do you think that they will change their name to AB company? No, they'll definitely not do it. A company has acquired B company. So now all the things which were relating to B company, be it its assets, be it its liabilities, be it any other thing, these are something which have already been acquired by A company. So A company is now having that rightful title for all those assets and liabilities. They are just going to be acquired by them. But then A Limited is certainly not going to change its name. They have acquired it completely. So that's the difference between a merger and an acquisition. That's how it's being done. And at the same time, I would also like to make you understand about consolidation as well, guys. If I'll talk about merger, acquisition, and then consolidation. Consolidation is basically the one where two companies are being united into a new corporation or a new company, okay, if I'll talk about, which assumes the entire assets and liabilities of the combining business. That's how it's being done. Consolidation is complete when two different entities meet together and they just dissolve both of them, and again a new company gets started with a new name altogether. Okay, it is same as merger. Okay, exactly same as merger, except that the new company is basically formed in it. So if I'll talk about merger, merger is basically the absorption of one company by another company. But then if I'll take the merger in extended form, which I just quoted you up in the beginning of the presentation, that was an example of none other than the consolidation part. Okay, so when merger takes place in such a form that a new company is formed, it is called as consolidation. And in a consolidation, both the acquiring firm and the acquired firm, both of them, they basically terminate their previous legal existence and they form part of a new firm altogether. So that was the example of consolidation, okay, which is an extended form of merger only. That is the difference between merger, acquisition and consolidation. Merger may happen in such a way that a new company may not be formed, but then still merger is possible because herein one company is basically absorbing another company. Okay, they are just retaining its assets and liabilities, but then they are not doing it in such a way that just not bothered about the shareholders of another company. Okay, they are not buying entirely or acquiring the another entity entirely. They are just collaborating. Okay, they are just absorbing in such a way that now the shareholders of that previous company, they will become the shareholders of this company. They are not supposed to get the money out of it, and that's why merger usually happens. The best feature of merger is, guys, that it may happen without even the introduction of cash. Can you even imagine if you ask about someone that I need to acquire something, I need to go for acquisition. Acquisition will definitely have the existence of cash or bank, whatever the case may be, in its core thing. But then if you'll talk about merger, if someone comes and asks me up this thing, sir, can merger can take place without the usage or existence of cash? Absolutely, it can be. A merger does not require cash. That is the beauty about merger, and that is how it is different from acquisitions. Okay, now that was one such example. My next slide is all about this thing only, which is what all are the advantages of mergers over acquisitions. Number one, which I just made you understand, was that a merger does not require cash. It doesn't require cash at all. If it's available, good enough. But then if someone asks me that can merger happen without the requirement of cash, absolutely it can be possible. Number two, a merger may be accomplished tax-free for both the parties. The best thing, and why people usually tell you of this thing, that why one should go ahead with a merger. Supposedly there are two companies. One company is having like very good profits, but then there is another company and they are having huge amount of losses. Now they want to just adjust their accounts in the best of the manner wherein they can save some amount of taxes for the growth making companies, and at the same time they can utilize the carry forward of losses for the company which is actually lagging behind. Merger can be the best form in that particular scenario, guys. Merger can be accomplished tax free for both the parties. We don't have to pay the taxes if in case merger is taking place in its right place. Next comes, a merger allows the target company to realize the appreciation potential of the merged entity instead of being limited to the sale proceeds. Now, had it been the case, I would have been like telling you about this thing, that what is the difference between acquisition and merger, guys. In case of acquisition, you are merely concerned as a shareholder with the kind of sale proceeds that you will get once your company gets acquired by another company. You are just bothered about that. But for a person, for a shareholder whose company is getting merged into another company, they will be more and more be influenced, and they'll give more importance to what they are actually realizing as the appreciation potential of the merged entity, because their entity is now getting merged into another entity. So how will it affect the growth of the merged entity overall, and how they will be affected once merger takes place? Will they be like getting benefited from this particular merger, or is it something that they'll be like actually lagging behind once the merger is being done? So they are not just interested and with the sale proceeds. Okay, in this particular scenario, they'll be more concerned and interested with the appreciation potential of the merged entity, and that's how merger is different from the acquisition. And lastly, a merger allows the shareholders of smaller entities to own a small piece of large pie. Again, that's a very good thing. Supposedly there is a company who is actually having a turnover of, let's say, just merely 1,000 crores, okay, but then there is another company with which this company is getting merged. They are having a turnover of, let's say, 50,000 crores. Okay, now 1,000 and 50,000 crores is a huge difference between them, and 50,000 crore company is also having very good potential as far as the profit revenue thing is concerned. So in this sense, the shareholders of that small entity, okay, they are getting a chance, an opportunity wherein they can own a smaller piece of that larger pie, okay, that larger merged entity. They can get a chance, an opportunity to own a smaller piece of that share of the merged entity as well, which is gonna be increasing their net overall growth. In any of the case, okay, they'll grow and they'll grow wonders. So that is again the beauty of mergers. These were the kind of advantages of mergers over acquisitions. I hope now you guys have got the complete fair basic understanding as to why you should go ahead with mergers and not with acquisitions, and how are they different from each other. Then comes synergy. Synergy, this is one of the very common kind of terminology that we use in our finance world. This question was asked in November 2012. So again, synergy, as the name is suggesting, it's basically sync and energy, okay? S-Y and energy. These are two different words wherein I can say that when you get a chance to synchronize, okay, your energy in such a way that you get the benefit when two different companies merge together, you create wonders, okay? Why is it said as a human statement that 1 plus 1 becomes 11, okay? It's normally being said, okay, if I'll talk about the Hindi term, people do usually call it as ek aur ek gyara. Why is it actually being told like this? The basic concept behind this thinking is when two companies gets into the same page, they develop the best of the possibilities. They create opportunities in such a way which couldn't have been possible. Had it been the case, they would have been like working alone. This is what synergy is all about. Synergy refers to the larger combined value of the merged firms than the sum of the individual entities. And that's how it's being done. Synergy may generate from, number one, substantial amount of financial resources in one firm and the profitable opportunities in another one. Let's suppose I've got a company who is cash rich. Okay, I've got best of the financial resources in my firm. And now there is another guy like you. Okay, you and your company are having so many, like n number of profitable opportunities. Okay, there is so much good thing about your company. Your company is something which is basically a very good startup. Okay, and it's about to blossom. And I am having like n number of financial resources with myself. Okay, what I'll do is I'll invest into your company, number one, or I'll just merge your company with my company, and then I will be investing my financial resources into your profitable opportunities. And this way, synergy will get created. Best thing. Number two, let's suppose my company is basically having a very good, a very strong research and development team. Okay. And then your company is having a very efficiently organized production department. So I can again just collaborate both the organizations in such a way that synergy gets developed. Lastly, for an example, a well-established brand of products, okay, they are having a very good product range, okay, but then they are having a very poor marketing team, and then I just contact another company and they are having a superb strong marketing organization, okay. So what I'll do is I'll just ask them that I've got the products with myself, kindly help me up with the marketing campaigns and other things so that I can sell out my products in the market in the well designed and well manner. Basically, this way synergy will take place. Okay, 1 plus 1 will become 11. This concept can be easily be linked to this synergy concept, and that's how it's being done. I hope you guys are clear with it as well. Wonderful, guys. Let's move ahead with the next topic. Why to go for mergers? People usually ask us why to go for mergers, why people usually merge with another entity. Number one is taxation advantages. Reliance, guys, Reliance is a very big example of mergers, because since the inception of Reliance, if I'll talk about the case laws which are today available in our country, okay, with respect to the judiciary system, almost 50% of the corporate cases are because of Reliance. Okay, Reliance being the pioneer, it's such a big company that whenever the government used to come up with some kind of alliance or some kind of reform, Reliance used to be the first one who used to get the same reform for its own benefit. And there used to be some very great cases wherein they have actually made the government actually stuck with their principles, okay, with their own reforms. Because this company, Reliance, are having best of the lawyers, best of the people around. And they somehow, I shouldn't say, but this, yes, they somehow get the loopholes wherein they can actually plan saving their taxes really well. So taxation advantages is one thing which is why you should go for mergers, because one company who is having some good amount of brought forward losses, it can merge itself with another company who's having like super profits. So again, the same will be like merged up and you'll get the taxation advantages in such case. Number two, an opportunity to grow faster with ready-made market share. For example, there is a company who's running like anything, okay, like anything, and it just merges another company with itself, okay. This is actually a very good opportunity for that second company to grow really faster, because there is another company who is having a ready-made market share in the market, and this will really help the second company to rapidly grow. For example, it was last year, okay, and the example will be relating to Havells and Lloyd. Havells is a very big company. Havells basically took over the consumer durable business of Lloyd. So Lloyd is primarily famous for its ACs, okay, air conditioners. Havells is basically famous for its lighting and other devices. So Havells acquired, I'm not too sure about this, they merged their consumer durable business of Lloyd, okay. And this was a really profitable opportunity for Lloyd, because initially their share really went down as compared to the core share price before the acquisition part. But then after a certain point of time, okay, it grew really well. So an opportunity to grow faster with ready-made market share is one of the best of the advantages for mergers. Then comes to eliminate a competitor by buying it out. Again, if I am not gonna buy your company, there will be another person who's gonna buy your company. So it's better that I should buy it, I should use it in such a way that synergy gets created and it will help me in best of my advantage for my merger. Next comes for better integration, be it horizontal or vertical. Or I can easily say that to stop the company's own takeover by the third party. Again, third party may come in and take over your company. So it's better that you come up to me and sell your company. At least you are getting the person who you want to sell your company at least. That's the best benefit of getting into merger, because herein you don't have to sell off your property or sell off your company, and I'm not supposed to acquire it. I'm basically merging it up. Then comes diversification with minimum cost. Again, there are two different businesses, two different companies working in all two different verticals, but then they just meet up so that diversification may be possible with their minimum cost. And lastly, access to new technology, suppliers, management, and so on. So your company is having good amount of technology, a superb technology if I'll talk about, superb suppliers. I am having here good amount of revenue. I know how to sell out things to people around. Okay, I've got a very good marketing team. Just collaborate, okay? You'll get some good things from my end. I'll get some good things from your end. And that will help us in accessing the best of the things in each one of us. So this is why we should go for mergers, and that is why it's being available. Let's go ahead with the last topic, and which will be about the three stuff. Why companies offer themselves for sale? Number two, why some mergers and acquisitions fail? And lastly, what is reverse merger? This will mark the ending closure for this particular presentation. Why is this presentation limited to all these topics? Simple, guys, because as far as theory of this particular chapter is concerned, you won't get any other question beyond the stuff which I made you understand in this particular presentation. This topic is altogether only and only related to the practical problems. Mergers and acquisitions, theory and conceptual things were just made in order to make you understand about this topic. That's all. This is going to be the last three topics, which is why companies offer themselves for sale. Number one thing, I can tell you the examples for it. Let's suppose there is a company who is having the sales, okay, and their sales are going rapidly down, okay, their earnings are going rapidly down, they're declining. What will they think? They'll first of all think about this thing that either they should merge themselves with some other entity or they should offer themselves for sale. Because after a point of time when they can't control the declining sales or declining earnings, the shareholders might start leaving. And once they start leaving, they'll have to ensure that they are able to fetch their own money into their pocket. So declining sale or earnings is one of the primary reasons for the companies to offer themselves for sale. Number two, a very uncertain future. Let's suppose there is a company who is having a very uncertain future. Okay, and after a point of time, it really bothered that company's directors and shareholders, and somehow they are now interested in selling off their own company. Then comes, owners do not find successor in sight. Let's suppose, for example, Tata. Ratan Tata was once finding out the successor for his companies, various companies, okay. Had it been the case, Mr. Cyrus wouldn't have come into the picture. What would have been done? Let's suppose there is no other individual who is under his sight, okay, and he's just not able to find any good person. What's gonna happen in this case? Okay, they would have got into this kind of scenario wherein they would have provided offer for sale for those companies because there is no successor, God forbidden, but didn't happen, so wonderful. Next comes, let's suppose there is a desire to maximize the growth, okay, under the umbrella of another larger company. Again, there is a very good possibility that there is another company and you know that this company is working like really wonders and you just want to sell off or your business or maybe basically provide the other company that merging power, okay, so that you can reap in the benefits of maximization of growth under the umbrella of that larger company as well. Good thing. Then there could be another possibility wherein you can raise some amount of cash for a more promising line of business. Again, you are getting some good diversification for your part. Okay, why won't you offer yourself for sale or for merger in that particular case? Then if in case your company is having, let's say, lack of adequate financial and management skills, so what you do, you'll have to offer your company for sale to that particular company because you're getting a very good chance that in case of offer for sale or merger, okay, you'll get a chance to again collaborate with some of the best of the financial managers and management teams wherein you can allocate all the things really properly in this case. Then this was all about the particular first thing, which is why a company offer themselves for sale. Next comes why some mergers and acquisitions fail. Why is it basically the thing that it usually happens up? Okay, poor integration strategies, guys. I have seen many of the mergers, many of the acquisitions which have failed miserably. Number one reason, poor integration strategies. They are just not able to integrate best of the strategies for their betterment. Okay. Then there are very good, or maybe I should say key employees of that one company are leaving. They have started leaving once merger or maybe acquisition was done. So again, it will fail certainly because the top personnel also started going. Then there is a lack of maybe a compelling strategic rationale. Okay, then again, there is very good chance that mergers and acquisitions are going to fail. Okay. Then the acquiring company did not do sufficient due diligence because by the time you were supposed to take care of the due diligence part in order to ensure that the company with which you are getting linked to is really the genuine one or not, or the kind of stuff which are going or happening in that company are really genuine, appropriate. If you were just not able to see through all these things during due diligence, certainly mergers and acquisitions are going to fall in this case. Then comes maybe corporate clashes going to happen in the market. And then let's say premium which was paid by the company was too high. Unrealistic kind of expectations are being set by the possible synergies. There is a very poor internal and external communication between the companies. All these things, guys, are the reason for mergers and acquisitions getting failed. Lastly comes, what is reverse merger? Have you ever heard about this thing that there is a company who's having a turnover of, let's say, 1000 crores, profits of just 2%. They are acquiring another company who is having 50,000 crore turnover and they are having profits maybe in 5%. Have you ever heard about this scenario? If not, then this is what reverse merger is all about. Reverse merger is something wherein the smaller entity basically merges the larger entity with itself, and that's how it's being done. So this is what reverse merger is all about, wherein the smaller company, the smaller and the weaker company basically merges the bigger company with itself. And that's how it's being done. Are you guys all through with this particular presentation? Are you guys all done with it? I hope you guys got the complete understanding as to what I made you understand in this particular presentation. And surely you guys are gonna go back to your place and revise. That is something which is gonna be the real imperative thing. Okay, guys. If in case you have liked this video, if in case you have found it really useful, do not forget to share it with your friends as much as you can, okay? And I'll see you in my next presentation with the kind of questions which have already been asked in C1 examinations to be made understand to you guys. Till then, God bless you all. Sayonara. Take care. Bye.